in 90 degree angle to the mirrors. So they go here and they go back in the same direction and go many times back and forth. And by doing this, they produce more and more photons of the same direction and the same wavelength. Do you know this? If you look, have two mirrors and look between them, you see yourself many times replicated. And this is the same principle here. It's very important that the mirrors are very parallel. Even some millidegrees distortion will make the laser unusable. So it's very complicated and you should not bump on a laser because mirrors can be deustated and then the laser will not function anymore. So this would also be useless if one mirror is only partly mirroring and it lets some energy out. And this is the energy with which we work. So we have many parallel rays here and some come out. And they have all the same wavelengths, the same phase, and the same direction. So with this principle, you have worked out the main laser light characteristics. The first is all the same direction, not as a light bulb every direction. It's a high light intensity, and it's monochromasia, but only one wavelength. The wavelengths depends on the kind of laser medium. We come to this later. So I will look in the chat if there are some already some questions. No. Okay. In the previous slide, you see the light comes out here. It can now comes out continuously. Or you can make it 100% mirroring and only make it transparent for a very short time. Then there comes only a very short impulse out. The first is the continuous wave mode when the ray comes out continuous. Then the second is a pulsed mode when it comes in very short intervals, and the Q-switched mode when it comes in even shorter intervals, nano to picoseconds, that's very short. And for what this pulsed, different pulsed lasers are useful, we will see in a minute. So now you can do a little math. It's only the only formula in my presentation. For example, you have a pulse energy of 1 joule, that's realistic, and a pulse duration of 1 millisecond. What do you think? How is the power? How many watts will the laser emit? You can think about a little bit. In the school, you know it's energy per time unit. And indeed, it's 1 joule divided by 1 millisecond. This is 1,000 watts. It's 1 kilowatt. It's not less, because you apply this on the skin. So same formula for the Q-switch laser. It's also 1 joule, but has 10 nanoseconds duration. Let's please calculate for a minute. It's unbelievable because it's 100 million watts. For example, these lasers are used for tattoo treatment. So you put 100 megawatts on the skin of a patient. And why it does not burn, we will see. How do you apply the laser? The most in dermatology, most are transcutaneous. So you put it on the skin and it penetrates the skin. For thicker indications, you maybe use an interstitial laser. You put a glass fiber in the skin for hemangiomas, for example, and for venous treatments, you use intraluminal, like a catheter. You see, there are many types of lasers. You may know many of them. Ruby laser is very common, the Alexandrit laser. You should have a feeling about what color the laser emits. These are infrared lasers, NDIAC, CO2, erbium, and there's also an ultraviolet laser. And most many lasers are in the visible spectrum. This will become important in the following slides. How does such a laser work? It should destroy a target structure, but it should protect the surrounding tissue. For example, if you want to remove a vessel in the skin, you can burn the skin, then the skin is go away and the vessel also go away. But this is not the, what you want. So we want to destroy the vessel and doesn't touch the surrounding tissue. And for this is a very important point is the thermal relaxation time. It's a time in which a structure cools down to 50%. For example, you heat it to 100 degree and this is the time when it reaches 50 degree. And this time is proportional to the size of the target structure. For example, a small structure has a short thermal relaxation time and a big object has a long time. This becomes important, for example, for a vessel, it's rather large, and the pigment particle, it's rather small. So we see how we can use this to only destroy the pigment target, for example. This is as a graph. You see the structure gets heated up to 100% and it goes down to 50%, and this is the thermal relaxation time. How can you destroy a target structure and thus do not destroy the surrounding tissue? The target structure must absorb the light better than the surrounding tissue. This depends on the wavelength and the how the target structure absorbs the light. This is a so-called selective photothermolysis. It depends on the wavelength. The second is the thermokinetic selectivity. This depends on the pulse duration. It must be shorter than the relaxation time. So, because if it would be bigger than the relaxation time, the structure will give the temperature to the surrounding tissue, and that you want to avoid. And of course, you have to put sufficient energy in the target structure to destroy it. So this selects the target structure among the absorption, and this selects the target structure from the size. So you must plan both to have the best result. I will show it in clinical examples. One other parameter is the penetration depth. Normally, as longer as the wavelength is, the deeper it penetrates. For example, NDIAC, rather deep, diode not so deep, ruby not, KTP and dye also not very deep. These two are exceptions because they are so strong absorbed in water that they will be absorbed in the epidermis or the upper dermis. They cannot penetrate deeper. And last, the diameter of the beam is important. Small diameters penetrate not so deep, and large diameters penetrate deep. For example, if you have a laser with only a small diameter, you cannot reach deeper structures. Even if you increase here the energy, it will not go very much deeper, but the burns here will increase. If you have possibility to use your largest beam diameter for a given laser, you should use it if you want to reach deeper structures. And the last thing is you want to treat normally things not on the epidermis, but deeper. So you should protect the epidermis, and the best way to do this is to cool it during the treatment and before and after. this can reduce side effects very, very good. We use mostly the cold air cooling from Zimmer, but also the cryogen spray cooling. So that was already the physics. Now we come to the laser medicine. But before we come, I would mention two very important things in the selection of patients. They can avoid many, many treatment errors and many, many stress from you.